ladies and gentlemen, I just want to make a quick announcement before we do the introduction here. Remind everyone there is no smoking in the hall, and we need to kind of keep the acoustic, yes, keep the acoustic conditions in prime condition. And keep it down a little bit. If we need to go over a little bit, maybe we will. But it's going to be fun. So I just wanted to remind everyone to be considerate, and it's going to be great. We'll be ready in just a minute.
You know, that's a Democratic speech in a Republican era.
I'm just talking to the dancer outside. He's in a good mood.
Yeah. Ready to go.
David literally just
I'm a little overcome. I wasn't quite sure what to do here today. But I just got an idea from my friend Brian. He asked me if I could just kind of chain him right to that wall and just leave him right there. But I do have a quote that goes along with that from a real fine book. And I got the idea to buy this from Bluegrass Unlimited, which is a great magazine. This is the life and times of Bill Monroe. Can't you hear me calling? Got a little quote I want to read out of here. And you all know, and I know, that we have some of the legendary starters of the whole bluegrass movement right here on the stage. Yeah. Mr. Peter Rowan. Mr. Vassar Clements. And Mr. David Grisman. Unbelievable. And we're all going to be brought together by that lovely, warm, bottom sound of Miss Bryn Davies. And here's my little quote. This is from the chapter called His Best Days on Earth, and it's page 209. The wind is blowing across the mountains and down o'er the valley way below. Rowan, a lover of Lord Byron and the romantic poets, sang right back, "It sweeps the grave of my darling. When I die, that's where I want to go." Ladies and gentlemen, bluegrass!
Thank you.
So everybody won't bring your water around. If you don't like your job, you can put your water bucket down. Is flying tonight. Can we come back to that? Actually, I was playing mandolin in a band with Bill Keith and Jim Rooney up in Cambridge, Massachusetts. And Bill Monroe was at the time traveling alone a little bit. He had a regular band that played the Opry with him in some local dates around the South, but he was starting to play up more in the college areas, and he came up to play Doc Watson's birthday party. Dave, were you there on that? Did you come up to Boston for that event? It was Doc Watson's birthday party, and Ralph Rinsler, who later worked for the Smithsonian Folklife Department, helped put the Newport Folk Festival together. Put a show together with Doc Watson and Bill Monroe, and actually there's a tape that came out of that show called Off the Record, Bill Monroe Off the Record, I think, or Bill Monroe and Doc Watson singing some of the old tunes. And so I was lucky enough to be the guitar player on that show, and Bill Keith played banjo, and Gene Loewinger played fiddle, Tex Logans played fiddle, and Everett Allen Lilly Jr. played bass. And we played about 3 dates in the New England area. And at the end, Bill said, Pete, you ought to come to Nashville, I can help you. So I went and got hipped. That's great. What? Oh. Tunes were on the same record, Muleskinner and In the Pines. longest train I ever saw went down the Georgia line. The engine passed at 6 o'clock and the cab passed by. In the pines where the sun never shines, and we shiver when the cold wind blows. Ooh, thank you.
more questions?
Hey, Peter. What was Bill Monroe like as a boss?
Pardon?
What was Bill Monroe like as a band leader and boss?
You got to ask Pete and Vassar. Vassar, what did you think Bill Monroe was like?
He didn't hire mandolin players.
That's the funny thing about Bill. He didn't hire, he did. David played with him quite a bit. And never paid him, but that means you were a real bluegrass boy, David. That, you qualify. Oh, well. You know, Bill Keith, when he told me that Bill Monroe was coming up and would I want to play with him, I said, yeah. And Bill said, but when in the band, don't call me Bill, call me Brad, which was his middle name, Bill Brad Keith. So he had to be called Brad Keith because Bill wouldn't have another Bill in the band. Your name was Bill. In fact, Billy Sue Forrester played accordion with him. It was Howdy Forrester's wife. He changed her name to Sally Ann Forrester. Vassar, what was Bill Monroe like as a boss?
I got along with him real good. A lot of people didn't, I think, but I was lucky.
He was lucky, I'll tell you that.
I knew his little ins and outs, you know.
Like, what were those ins and outs?
Having these different moves and everything.
Did I tell you?
Yep, you know,
moves. Another time, Gordon Terry and another player was on the bus with him. So him and Bessie was having a fight in the back. So Bill stuck his head out the door and Gordon had to be looking around like this, and he said, "You're fired." And he said, "So are you."
Well,
Gordon said, "I didn't do that." So he come back about 2 weeks later and said, "Our music is needed in Washington.
Our music is needed in Washington. Get ready to go." Let's see, Vassar. What? Oh, you. Yeah, we're gonna get up there. Vassar, you were about 14 years old, weren't you, when you started hanging out? Did you record?
It's been somewhere from that to I don't know what age.
Well, when did you first record the Muleskinner with
him? 49.
And you were how old? But Vassar started hanging out while Chubby Wise was still the fiddler.
Well, Chubby had quit.
He had quit. Yeah.
Jimmy Martin was hanging around.
Fill us in.
Both you guys are from Florida, too, right? Chubby.
Yeah. Chubby was from Ocala.
Chubby was the original bluegrass fiddler.
And Jimmy, he knew he was going to fire Mac. You know, and I think Mac knew it too, Mac Wise. And so Jimmy couldn't play guitar. He wanted to play like Lester Flatt, but not. And I told Bill, I said, "You ain't going to get no rhythm out of him like that." He said, "Well, what does he need to do? Get a straight pick where he can play the whole thing, you know." And I said, "Jimmy, back to back of the bus with Vassar, they didn't show you how to play with a straight pick." That's how that happened. And at first, we'd be through with the tune before he'd get his cape on the right place.
All right, let's reenact. This is how Bill would call a tune. And David will be Bill. Okay.
We'd like to feature Pete Rowan on a good lead number here.
Oh, you want to sing a good? That's a good racehorse song.
That's a good racehorse number.
Run, Molly, run,
Tenbrooks blind.
Old Tenbrooks blind.
Thank you.
like, the question was, what was the inspiration for dog music? I kind of like all kinds of music. That's what I think dog music is, actually. But, you know, I write tunes that are a little different than the norm, perhaps, and sometimes. I always liked all kinds of music, but I don't like just liking one kind of music. I love bluegrass. I actually like good music, actually. Duke Ellington is the guy that said there's only two kinds of music, good and bad.
Tell us about your mandolin.
Well, this mandolin is an old mandolin. It's made by the Gibson Company. Some guy's name is in it. I can't read it anymore, but it's a December 20th, 1922, Gibson F5, signed by Lloyd Lohr, the acoustic engineer, who got fired in 1924 for inventing the electric bass too early.
Y'all sang one together.
We might do this more than once this weekend. We'll try and do it the best we can, the original way.
take.